Now I request Swami Atmapriyananda to come and make his presentation. Swamiji, please.
And Anatma, that's more or less, I feel, private business. Sometime back, I met one Hindu sadhu. I really admire. He's really serving several thousand students' meal. Wonderful. So, he invited me. So after we tour, you see, his ashram. Then I told him the practice of Shila, practice of Shamatha, practice of Vipassana, we are saying. The Hindus, Buddhists, like twin brothers, truly. The only question is Atma and Anatma. That's private business.
Buddhism younger brother. Buddhism younger brother.
Kasa. Younger brother, yes, that's right. So I told him, you find useful about concept of Atma. I find useful the concept of Anatma. So that's private business.
Om yo brahmanam vidadhati purvam yo vai vedanscha prahinoti tasmai tamha devam atma buddhi prakasham mumukshur vai sharanamaham prapadye nishkalam nishkriyam shantam niravadyam niranjanam amritasya param setum dagathen dhanamivanalam om masato masadgamaya Tamaso ma jyotir gamaya, mrityor ma amritam gamaya, avir avir mayedhi, rudrayatte dakshinam mukham tenamam pahinityam. Om shanti shanti shanti, om shakti samudra samuttatarangam, darishita prema vijrumbhitarangam, samshaya rakshasa nasha mahastram, Yami Gurum Sharanam Bhava Vaidyam Advaya Tattva Samahita Chittam Projwala Bhakti Patavrita Vrittam Karma Kalevara Madhuta Cheshtam Yami Gurum Sharanam Bhava Vaidyam Naradeva Deva Jaya Jaya Naradeva.
May we begin with offering our very respectful salutations to His Holiness the Dalai Lama, whose presence is so inspiring. So I thought, in his presence, we should talk about illumined mind, because he has constantly been emphasizing compassion. And the ultimate aim of all philosophical texts, Upanishads, Gita in Vedanta, and other texts also, sarva bhuta hite rataha, a person should constantly be engaged in promoting the welfare of all beings. The idea of the bodhicitta and the compassion of the bodhisattva. When an illumined mind is just about to embark on nirvana, he is overcome by mahakaruna and renounces his own individual nirvana and comes back for sarva bhuta hite rata. That's the great sacrifice with a bodhisattva does. So the illumined mind, according to the Buddhist, yogic and Vedantic paradigms, and I also briefly want to touch upon its relevance in the modern age. Because all these philosophical discussions and seminars which we have will end up in nothing unless we can apply this in our daily lives for the transformation of an individual and collective consciousness to promote peace and harmony in this world. So there are three paradigms. The Buddhistic paradigm talks about the samyag-darshana. This is well known, the Punjab, the Ashtanga Yoga. It begins with samyag-darshana, passes through samyak-smriti, which is translated as right mindfulness, and leads ultimately to samyak-samadhi, which is difficult to translate. They call it meditation or concentration. And in the Vedantic parlance, we have the famous Gayatri Mantra, which is perhaps the most sacred mantra in the Vedas and the Vedanta. Dhiyo yo nav prachodayat. The concept of dhi, which is called buddhi, the buddhi guha, dahara kasha, hridaya kasha, hridyantar jyoti, medha, and so on. The same idea in the yogic parlance, the prajnaaloka, the light of higher wisdom, and the truth-bearing wisdom, ritambhara prajna. And in the modern age, this illumined mind is most vital for peace and harmony at the individual and the collective level. Now, once we go back to this age-old word called dharma, everything begins with that. And the Buddha calls it dhamma. It comes from the word, the verbal root in Sanskrit, dhatu, called dhru. Dhru means to hold. So I was thinking about the modern terminology for that. It is sustain. Now everybody talks about sustainability. The United Nations has come out with sustainable development goals. So sustainability has become an important word. We talk about sustainable development, sustainable agriculture. So whole concept of dharma is the principle of sustainability, which holds together and prevents it from falling apart. I'm reminded of a famous poem by W.B. Yeats. Very poignantly he says, things fall apart, the center cannot hold, mere anarchy is loosed upon the world, the blood dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. We can see that happening now. And Sanatana Dharma talks about two kinds of dharma. One is the pravritti dharma, the other is the nivritti dharma. Nivritti dharma leads to nishrayas or moksha, liberation. And pravritti dharma leads to abhyudaya, which is worldly prosperity. These are called prayas and shreyas, as you know, in the Kathopanishad. And both of them constitute a total holistic development of humanity. When things fall apart, the dark clouds of disintegration and anarchy looming grow large, and the modern scientific people are priding in their mind-boggling scientific and technological marvels, these marvels should not become a Frankenstein mindlessly abused so that the human race is at the peril of getting destroyed. Albert Einstein was asked once, what would be the weapons which will be used in the Third World War? He said, I do not exactly know, but I can tell you what weapons will be used in the Fourth World War. He said, what? Bows and arrows and stones. Because human civilization would have been completely wiped out. So we will start again from the animal stage. And it's our responsibility as human beings, intelligent, enlightened human beings, to prevent this. Now, we talk about advancement. Advanced countries, advanced nations. What constitutes advancement? Is it science? Is it technology? Is it the infrastructure? Is it the roads? Is it the cars which you have, the gadgets? Is it the ATM cards and the credit cards that you have? What constitutes advancement? This is being seriously now being debated, and the intervention of dharma in the form of cultivation of illumined mind is now extremely urgent. So the inner exploration, these are well-known concepts, they quickly go through. Vedanta talks about the five paradigm of the pancha kosha. These are not called koshas anywhere in the Upanishad text per se. Shankara called it koshas for his own purpose. They are called Atma. There are five Atmans: Annamaya Atma, Pranamaya Atma, Manomaya Atma, Vijnanamaya Atma, and Anandamaya Atma. We can also superimpose this on the Tantra paradigm of the Shat Chakras, because useful because we do not exactly see the Annamaya, Pranamaya Atma, except the Annamaya Atma, the Pranamaya and the Manomaya, although we feel them. The Shat Chakras can be located in the body, although they are not physical. You know the famous ones: Mooladhara, Swadhisthana, Manipura, Anahata, Vishuddha, and Agya. Now, we talk about consciousness and superconsciousness and unconsciousness. The word superconscious was introduced in psychology for the first time perhaps by Swami Vivekananda when he taught yoga in the West, the Raja Yoga. He said, Freud talk about the unconscious, subconscious, and conscious, but the yogi says there is something called superconscious beyond this. In the Western parlance, the waking state itself is a state of consciousness. But Vedanta says, even when we are waking, we are actually in a state of unconscious. What is actually conscious happens when the Vijnanamaya awakens. So the Mannamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, the vital mental sheaths, sukshma and subtle, all of them are classified as unconscious. And the first awakening of consciousness takes place when the Vijnanamaya, or the intelligence self as it is translated, awakens. In Vedanta you call it dhi, sattviki buddhi, the Gita, medha in the Medha Suktam, hridaya guha, yo veda nihidam guhayam parame vyoman, Taittiriya Upanishad, hridyantarjyoti, as in the Brihadaranyaka, and so on. In the Tantra it is called Anahata Dhvani, in the Kundalini, and the Hridaya Guha, and so on. In Yoga it is called Ritambhara Prajna or Prajna Aloka. Now why all this is important? Because all of us should remember we are sadhakas. We are not mere intellectual philosophers. We have come to realize the spiritual truths in our own consciousness and give the benefit of this realization to the world. This great institute, which has been founded for the study of Tibetan Buddhism, is meant to impart this great knowledge of Tibetan Buddhism vis-a-vis Vedanta and some aspects of modern science, so that human beings, the children, the students studying here, the faculty, will be able to live a life of elevated consciousness and realize a spark of that consciousness within themselves. There is all these seminars and talking about so many philosophical systems. They have no meaning unless they have a bearing on our individual and collective life and transform our lives. So there is in the Vedanta, I've called it secret stairs to super consciousness, word used by Swami Yatishwarananda, one of our illustrious monks. Annamaya and Pranamaya and Manomaya, up to that you are at the level of unconscious. Then when the Vijnanamaya awakens through dhi, buddhi, prajna, medha, you first realize yourself as a self or the Atman apart from the body. Atman and jada, chit jada granthi as we call them, somehow come together. You first realize yourself as an Atman in the body, rather than earlier conception that we are the body which is housing the spirit. Swami Vivekananda pointed out the Western and Eastern conceptions. In India we say if somebody dies, he has given up the body. Panchatva prapti. Sharir deha tyag kar diya. In the West they say he has given up the ghost, he has given up the spirit. So they think they are the bodies and they give up the spirit. We think we are the spirit who has rejected the body. So now when the Vijnanamaya opens up the individual level, you have a realization in which you can open up the cosmic aspect of the Vijnanamaya. This is another very scientific principle which has been integrated into Vedanta: microcosm, macrocosm, unity. the microcosm and the macrocosm are identical. You have the individual vijnanamaya, you have the cosmic vijnanamaya, which is called the cosmic mind. This is called Hiranyagarbha in Vedanta and Mahat in the Sankhyan terminology. The cosmic mind of which all our individual minds are parts. This has been realized even now at this level of matter. All of you know how the general theory of relativity due to Einstein owes its origin to a philosophical principle called Mach's principle, which said even at the level of matter we are one. Our bodies or individual matter are only particles in an infinite ocean of matter. At the level of the mind we are one because our minds are part of the Hiranyagarbha, the cosmic mind. And Vedanta proved ages ago, thousands of years ago, that our individual spirit is identical with the Supreme Spirit. At each level there is a conscious intermingling of the identity of the individual and the cosmic, the macrocosmic and the microcosmic. Now the ancient Buddhist yogis called this a continuous awareness, the right mindfulness, which is samyak smriti, sammasati in Pali, and the Eightfold Path. They call it as samprajanya. Swami Vivekananda is very fond of one quotation from the Upanishads, uttishtata jagrata. He said, I never preach anything except awake, 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 awake. You know the famous story when the Buddha told his dear disciple Ananda, be wide awake, Ananda. So this constant awakefulness has been very much emphasized. Or His Holiness fond of Shantideva's text. So I remembered this text. Shantideva describes, ekadeva samasena samprajanyasya lakshanam. Very briefly, if you want to describe samprajanya, it is yat kaya chitta avasthayaha pratyaveksha muhurmuhu. Continuously witnessing every moment, the state of the body and the mind in brief is the nature of samprajanya. The Theravada Buddhists, as you know, call this vipassana, the insight, which is one of the most important spiritual pursuits. Now, the dharma or the religion has been described by Swami Vivekananda as the manifestation of the divinity already in man. Just now His Holiness was mentioning, he said the goal is to manifest this divine within by controlling nature, external and internal. He also adds, this is the whole of religion, be free. Doctrines or dogmas or rituals or books or temples or forms are but secondary details. So I talked to you about this microcosm, macrocosm principle. So a new world order could emerge out of this illumined mind. So there are two important principles on which Vedanta is based. One, the divinity of all beings, and the second is oneness of existence, microcosm, macrocosm, identity. The first principle, the divinity of beings, could engender a new social philosophy as hinted by Swami Vivekananda, in which he said, the fact that the divinity is the explanation of the whole history of human progress in the material, intellectual, and the spiritual plane. It is therefore the duty of every soul to treat, think of, and behave to other souls as such as gods. When it is applied collectively, each one of us will treat everybody else, human beings, subhuman beings, animals, plants, knowing that the same divinity is pervading everywhere. Isha vasyamidam sarvam sarvam yatkincha jagattam jagat. Interpersonal relationships will get transformed, international relationships will transform, and the love and harmony. The second principle, the unity of all existence, this is a scientific as well as a philosophical spiritual principle, will involve the emergence of a new social science, Navina Samaja Vijnana, whose offshoots are already seen. All of you are aware that recent thinking in physics and the modern science is how we can unify various things and get to find out the theory of everything, TOE. Is it possible to have a unified field theory was the Holy Grail which Einstein was searching for. He was not successful. Now the whole thinking is how to come to a unified theory. So this is an offshoot of the idea of the oneness of existence. And the Samaja Navina Darshana, the social new philosophy based on divinity of existence, Navina Samaja Vijnana, new social science based on the oneness of existence, microcosm and macrocosm, leads you the Vedic vision of a divine life, which is exactly what all the prophets talked about. Even the great Buddha said, be good and do good, this is the whole of religion. If you can live a life of divinity in whatever name you call it, the Bhagavad Gita ends by saying, the ultimate realization is Vishate Tadanantaram. He enters into divine life. So this is the new challenge, and a new social consciousness will emerge, and we are sure that if each of us struggle for getting an enlightened mind, a mind which is luminous, a mind which is awakened, and a mind which is full with compassion and divinity. I will end with a quote from the Gita, in which he says, the mind has to be merged into the heart. Mano hridi niruddhya. How to meditate? Meditation takes place when the mind merges into the heart. The word uses niruddhya, arrested into the heart. A new combination of the mind and the heart will bring about a new transformation into ourselves. Religion participates of the heart rather than the brain. Buddhi or the dhi is actually a faculty of the heart. When intelligence of the mind integrates into the intense feeling and the realization in the heart and issues out into vibrant, effective action for the good of humanity, then humanity will get transformed. This has been the burden of the song which His Holiness has been propagating everywhere. How to transform human society based on peace, compassion, and harmony. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Thank you.
Thank you, Swamiji. An illuminated mind consists of enlightened consciousness and enlightened conduct. Prajna and Shil go Shil together.
Yeah.
And this is the crux of your presentation. Thank you very much. Now His Holiness. His Holiness is an embodiment of both enlightened consciousness and enlightened conduct.
Sir, this is your field.
And he's an inspiration for us.
The Bodhicitta, please say something about the Bodhicitta.
Because Namsha do share in Usane, and so Chichira Yachadi, big Hashmusha. Chisla, that has a doctor can do to her. As Namjanaria, any Karianda. It's Toba Dazan Sin, Ra, the Dosin to the Achik. That Chiras do this, and eh? Yeah, which Rav so. In the Chidi, Chil Chapting Inch. That the Zuyan Yachi. Ko she was resha. In the name, go Gingi, da Gingi Meda was shed to that the dosho, Gingi Takma, Gingi Chane, Gaia Medine. Six shares to her. Dear, call more, call Gizzy Gizzy, good was shenny, call Tapa Memeche, Gizzy Gizzy, Gibbetoniche, the good Gingi Chane, Gia Memeche. Didn't you yaw choke at the casual?
So this is not specifically in response to Swamiji's presentation, but in general, this concept of eternal manas, eternal mind. His Holiness was saying that it reminds him of an important point that Dharmakirti and Dignaga makes when we try to understand the world that we experience, that the way in which we impose categories into the world, and those knowledge that is based on those categories are really knowledge of general features rather than specific reality. So distinction needs to be made where our explanation or our knowledge or our conceptualization of a certain phenomena, is it at the general universal level, or is it we are talking about a more specific phenomenon that is lived experience? So that important distinction should be borne in mind. The other one is, you know, sometimes you have phenomena which from the point of view of its continuum is eternal. It goes on and on. But at the same time, phenomenologically speaking, you know, it is felt as if it has momentary, you know, kind of successions. So something can be eternal from the point of view of its continuum, but it could be momentary from the point of view of its own processes. Yes. So those ability to distinguish would be helpful.
Vedanta talks about pravaha, prava nityatva.
Time is up, and now we may have another presentation by Professor Bhaktchandra Jain. So he will be presenting the Jain perspective on Manas.